Hey everyone, welcome to worshipathome.online. This is our online campus for Cooper City Church of God. My name's Kevin. I'm one of the pastors here at Cooper City Church of God, and I want to say welcome to all of you joining us online today. I want you to do a couple things for me. First of all, we need you to get your Bible ready. We're going to have a lot of scripture that we're going to cover in the content of our teaching today. You can download a Bible at uversion.com or bible.com. You can also use the app at our church website, which is Cooper City Church of God, and we have a Bible reading plan on there. And you also have the notes from today's teaching, as well as past teachings, and you can go and listen to past Sunday mornings or Wednesday experiences. And as we've been online for these last several weeks, most of you have been engaging with our app and on our website. So I just want to remind you, as we begin to open up and we had our first weekend back, stay connected to the app because it gives you information about all the things that are going on around here at our church. And one of those incredible things is this coming next week is going to be Father's Day weekend. We're excited about welcoming Reggie Dabbs to be our special guest speaker. And Reggie's becoming one of our favorites here at Cooper City Church of God, and you're going to be blessed by his ministry. He'll be online, and he'll be with us on campus. So no matter if you're staying at home, still worshiping with us there, or if you're here worshiping with us in the building, we look forward to you being able to be a part of Reggie's ministry. I want you to turn in your Bibles today to John chapter 17, verse 21. And we're continuing a series that I started last week, and I'm calling this We Must Get This Right. And this whole series is centered around love and how genuine love is the foundation for our unity and our coming together and our ministry of reconciliation as the church. We kicked off this series last week, and we talked about John chapter 17, verse 21, and this is what Jesus prayed to the Father. He says, I pray that they will all be one just as you and I are one, as you are in me. And when we see this, we see the Father's prayer. We see Jesus' prayer, rather, to the Father. And he was praying this, saying, I want to see unity among people like there's unity among you and I. And saying, like God, the way you and I love one another as Father and Son, I want to see our people love one another that way. And I shared online and on campus last week in a couple of our notes, and I wanted to remind you of those. First of all, I believe that there is no institution on earth more equipped or more capable of bringing transformation to the cause of racial reconciliation than that of the church. We have the power within our grip, and we have the ability and the anointing and the gifting of God and the ministry of reconciliation. And I also said this, if we're not helping people reconcile, we're not being the church that God intended for you and I to be. So we have an obligation to minister reconciliation to one another. And we do that by affirming each other with dignity, acknowledging that God has created us uniquely different by design, also by forgiving one another, and then lastly, by genuinely loving one another. And so today I'm going to be talking about this subject, make us one. And the heart of what I want to share today is listed right here. The church will lose its effectiveness if we are not operating in unity. I'm going to speak into that today, and I'm going to talk about how a unified church is the only powerful church left, and a disunified church is really non-existent. It does not have any power. It does not have the blessing and the anointing of God upon its life. And unity can be defined in its simplest terms as oneness of purpose. It is us working together in harmony toward a shared vision or goal. Unity is not uniformity. It is not us always having to agree with everything, nor is it sameness, but just as the Godhead is made up of three distinct persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, unity reflects oneness that does not negate individuality. Unity does not mean that everyone needs to be just like everyone else, because God's creativity and by design, as we talked about last week, we know that he crafted humanity in very different shapes and colors and styles, and we all celebrate that diversity today. And as we discussed last week, each of us are unique. None of us is like the other, and that's a beautiful thing that God intended. And so I wrote this down in your notes if you're following along on the app. If not, look here at the screen. Unity occurs when we combine our unique differences together as we head toward a common goal. It is knowing that we are gathered for and moving towards something far bigger than our own individual preferences. I believe this, the church is the only institution on earth obligated to live under God's authority when enabled to do so through the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's made clear in this passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Look at what Paul says when he's writing to the church here. He says, the human body has many parts, But the many parts make up one whole body. So it is with the body of Christ, talking about the church. He says, some of us are Jews, some are Gentiles, some are slaves, and some are free. But we have all been baptized into one body by one Spirit, and we all share the same Spirit. Now, when you and I are saved, we're baptized because of our accepting of Jesus Christ and Him giving us forgiveness of our sins. We become baptized into the family of God, and we're now identified with a new family, having been placed into a spiritual environment, yet while we're still here on this sin-cursed world. So no matter what our gender is, no matter what our ethnicity or our class, no matter where we came from, and no matter even where we're intending to go here on this earth, when we come to Jesus, we enter into a relationship with brothers and sisters in Christ as the family of God. And even though families have differences and disagreements, when it's all said and done, we still love one another and we work hard to stay united. Ephesians chapter 4 says it this way in verse 3, make every effort, everybody say every, make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. Notice that the scripture uses the term keep yourself united. Other translations say it this way, be diligent or preserve unity. And one translation says work to keep unity. All of these translations indicate that we don't create unity, but instead we work to keep it, to protect it and preserve it. Authentic unity cannot be mandated or manufactured by we as humans. God desires that His standard and His standard alone serve as the foundation for unity. The Holy Spirit created unity within us when we were saved. Our job is to find out what the Spirit has already done so that we can live and walk and embrace that reality and the unity that has already been given to us. So this topic of unity is paramount for the church. It always has been. Back when the epistles were being written and back when the Word of God was being translated, you hear a lot talking about unity, and we're going to see a lot of those scriptures here today from the Word of God, and it's still applicable to where you and I are today. And as we work to preserve and to keep and protect our unity, God's Word also challenges us to watch out for people, especially in the church, who try to bring disunity. He says here in Romans chapter 16, verse 7, he says, I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause division and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. He says, avoid them. God places high value on unity in the church. Unity is essential to the church in order for us to reflect the values that the kingdom of God is on the inside of us, and that the kingdom of God is a part of our congregation to a world who is desperately in need of experiencing Christ. God's kingdom includes people from all nations and all cultures. Spiritually, we can be unified and we can accomplish more when we begin to expand our worldview and get a God's eye view of what it is that He determined for the world when He created us. We must see each other more intimately and clearly than our limited exposure and understanding sometimes allows for us to. Pastor Tony Evans from Texas, he had this powerful insight regarding the kingdom of God in this story. And he says it this way, every 2 years, nations around the globe send their strongest, most elite athletes to compete against others at what is known as the Olympics. Individual athletes who are at the top of their game in their particular skill or event go head to head with the world's best, on display for the world to see for their individual prowess, their individual determination, their individual commitment, and their individual abilities. Yet, when the gold medalist stands on the platform, he or she is not asked, what is your favorite song? The winning athlete does not get to choose which song will be played as the flag is raised. Instead, the national anthem for whatever nation that they are representing individually is played loudly. This is done, and it is understood that it is played while they stand there as individuals who has sacrificed and has practiced and competed. And he or she is not just representing themselves, but they are representing their nation at large. Growing up in America, we were regularly reminded to whom we belong to each time we said the Pledge of Allegiance, or any time that we participated in the singing of our national anthem in schools or assemblies or before sporting events or before civic events in our community. It was clear then, and it is today, that our country did not want us to forget that we were Americans. We recited the pledge day in and day out, allowing it to sink in, enabling each of us to fully understand that no matter who we were or what our background was, our history, gender, culture, or color, we belong to this kingdom called the United States of America. This story is a reminder that we, as followers of Jesus Christ, we belong to another kingdom. We belong to another realm. No matter where we live, no matter where we work, no matter where we may travel on this planet, we are all citizens of another kingdom, and that is God's kingdom. And I wrote this in your notes. This is such a truth. The world is only our temporary home. And can I just pause right here and say that too many of us have gotten it twisted. Too many of us have allowed the pressures and the realities of the negativity of the world to become our reality, and instead keeping our eyes fixed on the future, which is the future of our kingdom, and understanding that God's kingdom is really going to be our eternal home and our eternal reward. It's like another story that I heard about a man who needed to get his shoe repaired, and he went to a shoe repair place, and it was right at 5 o'clock, and he went and he looked, and there was no cars in the parking lot, and he was just disappointed, and he's like, I'm too late, they've already closed. But he decided, I'll go to knock on the door, and he went to pull on the door, and the door was locked. But he knocked on the door, and inside he could see the shoe repairman. And the shoe repairman, who was an older, feeble man, he kind of made his way to the door, and he knew and recognized him because he had been a previous customer. And he unlocked the door, and he opened the door, and he said, you came just in time. I was just about to leave. He says, I was almost ready to go home. And then he looked around, seeing the empty parking lot, and the man asked, how are you going to go home? I don't see any cars. How are you going to get there? He said, oh, that's easy, the repairman says. He said, do you see those stairs over there in the corner? And the guy said, yes, of course I see those stairs. He said, I live up there. He said, but I just work down here. And I thought about that story because as brothers and sisters in Christ, we need to understand we are going to live up there. And truthfully, right now, we should be living up there. Our hearts and our minds and our spirits should be fixed on things above and not things that are here on this earth. And we just work down here. Philippians 3, verse 20 says it this way. We are citizens of heaven. Christ, the one who saves us from the punishment of sin, will be coming down from heaven again, and we are waiting for him to return. Church of the living God, heaven is our home. That's the kingdom to which you and I belong. We just work down here. We just live down here. We're just playing down here right now. Understanding that this key spiritual truth is fundamental to all that we do on earth. We are not here forever. We're just pilgrims passing through. We are living here temporarily. The kingdoms of this world will try to force us to forget where our eternal home is. The world will try to lead us to believe that this is only what we have, which is here and now, and where we work and where we live is all we're living for. We have to remember that we're not here for long. We're here only for a short while. But while we are here on earth, God wants us to see heaven come down. He wants us to experience and share a little bit of heaven on earth, not just for ourselves, but with others. We see this through the model prayer of Jesus in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In other words, Jesus is saying that he wants us to have an understanding that God wants a little bit of heaven to be exposed here on earth. And it is essential for us to understanding that God's will, he wants his will to be done not only in heaven, but he wants his will to be done on earth. We know this because of the model prayer, the Lord's Prayer, and it has been given to us in Scripture as a pattern for prayer rather than as something that we just designate for recitation. Here's what I know. When the original Greek is looked up, it says in the book of Matthew that this prayer, when Jesus said this, he said, pray like this. And it literally means to pray in a similar manner. So if we pray in a similar manner, like Jesus taught us to pray, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, then we're praying for the principles of a heavenly realm to be brought to this earth. And for us to be able to reflect those God principles on earth, it can only be done when we fully understand and apply these principles to our life. Psalms 89, verse 14, gives us a few of those principles. There are four right here in just this small passage. It says, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. And then it says, unfailing love and truth walk before you as attendants. You see, church, righteousness and justice is principles of what God wants to have involved in his kingdom. We must exercise righteousness and justice in the kingdom of God. He also says that the love and the truth will be a part of this. So we have righteousness and justice, but we also have truth and love. These are principles in the kingdom. And listen to this in your notes. Knowing and understanding and applying God's plan for righteousness, justice, love, and truth are essential to experiencing all that God has in store for us while we're here on this earth. Submission to God's plans opens up the flow of heaven's involvement in our lives and on earth. Unfortunately, too many Christians are satisfied with the part of us one day being able to go to heaven. And yet, a lot of us don't want to see heaven being brought down to earth. But in order for us to bring heaven or peace of heaven and a part of heaven and the kingdom principles of heaven down to earth, we must do what God wants to be done. And we must pray like Jesus, let it be on earth as it is in heaven. So how does this apply to what we're seeing right now going on in our world and in our nation and in our culture? Two of the primary reasons that I believe we have not been able to solve racial reconciliation thus far in America is that after hundreds and hundreds of years, people who are apart from God are trying to create unity. We see efforts of that, and some of them are valiant efforts, but let me tell you something. True unity is not going to be created without the Spirit and the presence of God. And then the second primary reason I think that we failed is because of the church. At the same time, when people are trying to create unity without God, people who are under God and already have unity, we're failing to live it out in full unity. And the result of both of these conditions is disastrous for us in America and as a culture. Our failure to find cultural unity as a nation is directly related to the church's failure to preserve and to protect our spiritual unity. A great example of unity happened on the day of Pentecost when God's people began to speak with other tongues. And in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, we find that the Holy Spirit showed up and people began to speak in other languages. And they didn't even know all these people that were gathered in the city, but all of these different ethnicities and all these different nations and all these different backgrounds were there united for the festival. And when people heard the apostles speak on the day of Pentecost, they were from all over the world. They were representing, the scholars say, at least 16 different geographical areas or ethnic groups. But in spite of the great diversity, they found true unity in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Listen, our nation, America, is a great nation. I think it's the greatest nation on the face of the earth. And we've made some great strides over the last several decades in attempting to bring people together, especially bringing diversity together across racial lines. But just like the zigzag crack in the Liberty Bell, a great divide still remains. And the divide exists also in the body of Christ, offering the world a broken reflection of the heart of our Christianity. We have a long way to go towards achieving authentic spiritual unity. But I hope and I believe and I pray that it can happen, especially in my lifetime. I believe that with all of my heart. I believe that it begins with love, like I shared last week, and genuine love, a love that is unconditional, a love that will forgive even when someone has done wrong to me or done wrong to us. I believe it also has to happen when we remove the lens of our fleshly worldview and our cultural worldview, and we replace it with a biblical worldview. We allow too much of the world to filter in to our vision and even our makeup, and we start reacting just like the world does instead of remembering that this is a temporary home for us. I put this in your notes. If we want heaven to visit history like what happened in the book of Acts, we have to apply a biblical worldview. In other words, we must view humanity through the lens of Scripture, seeing each other as we see with the vision of God. There's a prayer that I was taught by one of my spiritual mentors and a former pastor that I work for who's passed on now, but he had this prayer that we had actually as a placard that was up, and it was very visible every time we'd get ready to walk into the auditorium, and it said, "Lord, help me to see what you see when I look at people." You see, I believe that when we begin to look through the eyes of Christ, that we will see people for who they are. See people not just because of the skin color or not just because of their economic status or but by their ethnicity or even by their class of society, but we instead will see people for who they are, and every person is created in the image of God and every person has a soul. You see, I want to submit to you today that Satan spends a great deal of his time trying to divide the body of Christ. Why does he do that, you might ask? It's because he knows that God's power and glory are both accessed and magnified through unity. If Satan can keep Christians ineffective due to lack of unity, he will prevent the church from providing a model of the kingdom of God as an alternative to its chaos that we're living in right now. And this is where I say that we are going to lose our effectiveness as a church if we don't learn how to be unified. Listen, if someone's an alcoholic, you don't go to them and ask them how to stop drinking. And if someone is looking for love and looking for genuine love and looking for unity and looking for people who can get along and live in harmony together, if they come to a church and they hear people who are bickering or backstabbing or gossiping or slandering, we've lost our ability to teach them the way to heaven and to teach them the kingdom principles. And so I don't want us to lose our effectiveness because we have lost our unity. And I put this in your notes. A church that isn't unified will no longer be effective as a voice of hope to a lost and dying world. Unity is critical, church. Unity is something that we must have, we must preserve, we must protect. And listen, the world doesn't need to hear another message preached about unity. They need to see people living in unity. That's what we must do. All of the preaching and all of the Bible studies in the world can never bring about the fullest possible manifestation of God's presence, like us functioning as the church is intended to function and us living in a spirit of unity with one another as the body of Christ. John 13, 35 says this, "Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples." We talked about this last week, that the church needs to have proof. Proof in the pudding, as they would say. And when people look at us from the world, they need to see we are a people that's not just saying it, not just singing it, but we are living it out. Jesus Christ himself placed a tremendous emphasis on the desire for us to be one as he prayed in John 17, as we say, but this isn't something that we just do once a month or even on some unity month or some solidarity Sunday. This is a mandate from our Lord and our Savior that we be one, not only vertically with him, but one horizontally with one another. Another benefit of unity is talked about by the psalmist David in the Old Testament in Psalm 133. Look at what it says. "Behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head running down on the beard of Aaron running down on the edge of his garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore." Unity is where the blessing of God rests. It's coming down from heaven to flow onto the head and then down onto the body and even reaching as far as the mountains of Zion. In other words, when unity is flowing, it covers everything in its path. But the reverse is also true. Where there is disunity, there is limited blessing. We cannot operate in disunity and expect the full manifestation of God's blessing in our lives. Disunity at its core reduces the movement of God's favor and blessings. Jesus made it clear that a house divided cannot stand against itself. Whether it's your house, where it's the church house, or whether it's the White House, division leads to destruction. Not only that, but a spirit of dishonor can lead to the same destruction. Look at this in your notes. Honor promotes unity while dishonor promotes division. Dishonor is not the same thing as disagreeing. Listen, we're not always going to agree with one another. A person can disagree with one another and also still do it in an honorable fashion. To disagree with a procedure or to disagree with a statement or to disagree with ideology, every person, especially in America, every American has that right. But as a believer, as a part of another kingdom that we've talked about, we can be in disagreement, but we ought to frame it in the spirit of respect and honor for the position and the person in question. Otherwise, disunity starts to be bred. Disunity starts to spring up in his birth. And however, when we live and work in oneness and we work towards unity, God is invited to manifest himself in ways that we could only imagine. If we go back to the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2, verse 1, I believe that God supernaturally manifests. In fact, we read here where it says, on the day of Pentecost, they were in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Notice that before the mighty rushing wind, the move of God was preceded by unity. They were together in one place. And I literally looked this up in the Greek, and it literally says together means that they were together. And so when they were together in this place, it didn't mean that they were just together in proximity in a house, but it meant that they were together, unified. They were seeking God. They wanted the same thing. They had the same goal, the same desire. And God manifested himself in a powerful way. And I submit that for us to see revival in our churches and in our nation and in our homes, we must come together once again. At the end of the chapter of Acts, at the second chapter, that is, the presence and the product of unity is once again on display. It says, a deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders, and all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. Miraculous signs and wonders took place when they were together. God manifested himself when they were unified. Now, what made this moment in history and this period of time so electric was that the Spirit of God had taken over. Their unity paved the way for miracles to happen. I don't believe those miracles would have happened if it had not been for their unity. And the best programs, the best technology, the best buildings can be built and formed and fashioned for us to try to meet the needs of people. But let me tell you, these people didn't have any of that. In fact, they hardly had any income at all. They were just normal, common people. They had no notoriety. They had no academic achievements. They had no charisma. They were simply common people who were hungry for a move of God. And that's what you and I need today in the church. When they became unified as one, God poured out his blessing from heaven upon them. God chose to do things supernaturally to honor their unity. Conversely, remaining in an environment of disunity, trying to be intellectual about things, which is not always a bad thing. We need to use our mind, but sometimes we can overthink things. When we try to over-spiritualize things, and sometimes we try to do things with social experiments and all these other things. And listen, I'm all for innovative ideas, and I'm all for creativity, because we're a part of a culture and a part of a team that believes that as a church. But sometimes, listen, you got to strip all that stuff away, and you just got to get back to the core of the things and say, listen, we need to come together. And when we come together, we can have all the dialogue we want. We can have all the discussions. We can research and we can read and we can learn things better. And yes, we will continue to do that. But at the end of the day, we need to come together and we need to be unified so that the manifestation of the presence of God can be realized over our lives, over our marriages, over our homes and our families, over our church, which will bleed out into the streets, and over our nation and literally around the world. You and I have the power today. You and I have the ability because of the Holy Spirit that works on the inside of us. And listen, my Bible teaches me that greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. And so the things that are in the world and the things that the world is trying, they failed. They failed before. They're going to continue to fail. But listen, the things of God will never fail. He is going to allow us to succeed if we put our hope and trust in him. And if we trust him today and say, God, I want you to put us in unity as a body of Christ. Help us to love one another. Help us to link arms and to link hands and to be together spiritually so that we can be a fortitude. Yes, we need to pray together. Yes, we need to worship together. Yes, let's go to Bible study together. But God, help us to see eye to eye. Even where there might be a disagreement, we're still going to honor one another in unity. A great pastor out in Texas named Robert Morris, who's from the Gateway Church, he shared this illustration, and I heard him tell this, and I wanted to share this. It's from a couple of years ago, but I thought it was relevant to what we're facing today. And he held up a water bottle like this. And if you focus on this water bottle, I want you to look real close. I want you to see what's on the front of this water bottle. And literally just tell me what you see right now. There's a word there, and I'm not trying to trick you, but there's a word. I can't see it, but you can see it from where you are. And here's what Pastor Morris said, and this is something he said. Now, all of you can see what's on the front of this water bottle. He said, but what I see is something different. It says cash refund. And then it says, my glasses aren't strong enough to tell me. It says sip and scan, and here's 100% recyclable. But what you're seeing on the front, I can't see. And what I'm seeing back here, you cannot see. And here's what's wrong with the church today, and here's what's wrong with a lot of people in culture today, and it's really a simple thing that we can address, and we can do this from the perspective with spiritual eyes. Until I walk around the bottle, or until I come around on your side of the issue and look and see what you're seeing, I'll never understand what you're seeing, and I'll never understand what you're feeling. And until you walk around to my side and you see what I'm seeing, you will never understand what I look at, and you'll never understand what I feel. Listen, that is it in a nutshell today. What I'm trying to tell you is that we bring unity to the body of Christ. And sometimes that means that the Holy Spirit allows us to have a different viewpoint, a biblical viewpoint, a godly viewpoint. When we look at things from God's eye view, we see things very differently. We're no longer skewed. Our vision is no longer clouded and cluttered because of what we see and what we even believe, and because of what we see on our side, we learn to embrace some other things. It doesn't mean that we accept it, but it says, you know what, I can see what you're seeing now, and now at least I get a glimpse of what it is that you're understanding. And there's no better testimony of this, in my humble opinion, than when Jesus was on the cross. Jesus was being hung on the cross, as being brutally murdered by these people, and through blood-stained eyes, as the blood flowed over his eyelids and over his pupils, he looked through those blood-stained eyes, and he said these words, "Father, forgive them, for they don't even know what they're doing." And if Jesus is our Messiah, and he is our King, ruling in the kingdom that one day we're going to live in for eternity, and the kingdom that we're trying to live in now while we're still a part of this sin-cursed world, if Jesus can forgive those who have murdered him, and it was attempting to murder him and eventually succeeded, then you and I must have the mind and the love of Christ so deeply on the inside of us that we can forgive others when they've done us wrong. And listen, I'm talking to some Christians right now. Some of y'all have blown up just because of things that have been said. Some of you even blow up just because of things you thought were said. And that is not of God. We need to learn as the body of Christ to listen to one another and to change our viewpoint and our focal points, and to say, you know what, I don't know if that was them, and I don't know if they said that. That doesn't sound like them, because that's not the person I know. But I'm going to go to my brother, and I'm going to go to my sister, and I'm going to make things right. You see, that's what love does. That's what righteousness and justice does. And that's what we must do today in the church. Oh, that we could be the body of Christ that God had designed us to be and God has intended for us to be. I believe it will turn the world upside down. It won't just fix reconciliation of the races. It will fix everything. People will see the love of God. They will know, and the proof will be, because of their love for one another, they will know that we are his disciples. I want to close today, and I want to pray over you. I want to give you just a couple of last final scriptures. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 2, it says, "Complete my joy." This is Christ talking through Paul. He says, "Complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind." This is the power of the Holy Spirit that was working through this man as he was talking to the church at Philippi. And he was like, if you guys can just do this, if you can get this right, then my joy will be complete. I believe that God's speaking that over our lives today. Church, if you can get this right, then my joy will be complete. I believe if we can get this right, that the coming of the Lord will even be sooner. Another passage of Scripture says it this way in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. It says, "Finally, all of you should agree and have concern and love for each other." That's that word again, love. "You should also be kind and humble. Don't be hateful and insult people just because they are hateful and insult you. Instead, treat everyone with kindness. You are God's chosen ones, and he will bless you." I want to pray a prayer of blessing over you today. And I pray that in this moment, if the Holy Spirit is convicting you right now, that you need to protect and you need to preserve and you need to work harder to keep unity, whatever that looks like for you, I want to ask that the Holy Spirit empower you and I to do that right now. We are no longer going to be divisive. We're no longer going to be divided. We're no longer going to allow the traps and the schemes of Satan to cause disunity in the church. We're not going to get upset over little things or even over great things, because we know it doesn't matter on this side of eternity. One day we're going to spend forever in heaven together, and we need to get it right. Let a little bit of heaven come down to earth. Can I pray over you right now? Just bow your head with me. Let's pray. Lord, I pray that you would allow us to be the answer to your son's prayer, Jesus, when he prayed in John 17, God, "Let them be one as you and he, the Father, are one." Lord, I pray that you would help us get this right. We must get this right, Lord. We need to love one another, and we need to fight to protect and preserve the unity that you gave to us when we were saved. Don't let the evils of this world rob us of our unity with our brothers and sisters. And may the church of the living God be overflowing with righteousness and justice and truth and love. God, heal our hearts today. Heal our church today. Lord, I ask that you would do the miraculous and heal our nation today. And God, in turn, heal the world. The world is looking to us. The world sees us as a power and as a leader. And God, we must get this right. May it happen with me. May it happen with us in the church of the living God. May we do all that we can to forgive and to love and show compassion to one another, that the unity of the church will prevail. We will fight hard to protect it for your glory. And we thank you for it. And we give you praise in advance because it is only going to be done through the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Listen, think about this as I close today. Do not allow disunity to stop the flow of the blessings of God over our lives. Let's come together, church. Let's come together, people of God. And let's stand in amazement to watch what God will do when he can find a church that is unified. There is no telling what can happen in that moment. Listen, if you pray to accept Jesus today as your Lord and Savior, and if you're committing him as your Lord and Savior and you're asking him to be the forgiver of your sins, please text the word forgive to the number on the screen, 954-951-4747. We want to send you a free digital resource. We also have a 24-hour prayer line. Whenever you're watching this online, you can call this number, 844-680-7729. Call someone who's ready right now to pray with you on the phone, and they're going to minister to you. And they're going to worship with you, and they're going to pray with you, and they're going to bless you in the name of Jesus. Thank you for tuning in today. It's been an honor to be with you. I look forward to seeing you in church soon if you've not already been here. And make next Sunday and next weekend special for Father's Day. Join us as our special guest Reggie Dabbs will be with us. It's going to be an incredible weekend. God bless you. If you haven't heard it today, I love you. Take care.